Hello, and thank you for joining us for the Cambridge Report on NECAT Television. I'm Vincent Thompson.
And I'm Pamela Hunt. Coming up, we'll meet a student athlete who runs circles around the competition. We'll show you how some enterprising students have turned a cup of joe into cash. And we'll look at how Nashville's art scene is showing students creative career opportunities.
First up, concussions suffered on the football field were once thought to be a temporary condition. But researchers have discovered that head injuries can cause long-lasting effects, or even death. Taylor Hines shows us how Tennessee is taking measures to keep high school athletes safe.
The Tennessee concussion law, which becomes effective January 1, 2014, will protect those in community and or school-based athletic activities. Billy Bob is a young man being held from play due to his regularly concussion symptoms.
I was scared and sad because I couldn't play football at the time, and I didn't know if I would be able to play again.
The law states that an athlete cannot return to action until they receive written clearance to play by a doctor of medicine.
It was painful. My head was rattling. I was seeing splotches in my eyes, headaches, lightheadedness, dizziness, memory loss, seeing off the doctors, found out that I had sleep apnea.
Turning too soon could potentially harm the athlete in the future.
Sure that an athlete does not return to competition too soon is two things. One, if they come back too soon, they can get what's called a second impact syndrome, and it's where the brain hasn't fully recovered, and they come back and take another hit, and a lot of times it's just a light hit, nothing real big, and it will have them make their symptoms come back, and it will extend their recovery time returning back to play.
The steps for an athlete to return are simple. Step 1, light aerobic exercise. The goal is to increase the student athlete's heart rate. Step 2, moderate exercise. The goal is limited body and head movement. Step 3, non-contact exercise. The goal is more intense but non-contact. Step 4, practice. The goal is regenerate. Step 5, play. The goal is to return to competition. And last but not least, the most important goal is for Tennessee to make sure that all student athletes are not put into harm's way and they're safe when doing what they love, playing sports.
For more information about Tennessee's policies about concussions, log on to www.tssaa.org.
Some teachers want it, some teachers need it, and some teachers couldn't make it through the day without it. We're talking about caffeine. Brian Medrano introduces you to a group of students who could give Starbucks a run for their money.
In Cambridge High School, there is this program that surfaced a few years ago. This program helped the life skill class learn how to interact with teachers and students. They were taught the importance of benevolence. We asked who started this Cambridge Cafe program.
It started with Miss Neal. Miss Neal came from Stratford, and she had that coffee cart over at Stratford.
Chris gives us insight on what they give in the Cane Ridge Cafe.
Someone likes some coffee, tea,
cappuccino,
or orange juice.
Or orange juice. That's right. We offer orange juice, don't we? That's right.
We talked to one of the teachers in the life skill class, Mr. Frinsley, as he explained what this program is about.
They have like four or five different things they have to do on the cart. What they have to do, they have to take, one of them will be the one that pushes it, one takes the orders, one prepares the cart, and then you have an assistant manager and a manager, so you get to learn some supervisory skills too, because they are the one responsible for getting the cart ready, right, Chris?
Right.
That's right. And what it entails getting these kind of students right here motivated and ready and job ready.
The students don't charge money for the coffee, but they do ask for donations for the Life Skills program.
Bailey Dean looks like a typical teenager, but her girl next door looks had a killer instinct on the track. Bailey is a state champion in cross country running. Tia Mitchell has her story.
The students at Cambridge all have a great skill or talent of some sort. One student in particular is Bailey Dean.
I run anywhere from 5 to 8 miles a day. Sometimes I do less.
sometimes maybe more, just depending on the day. Right before a meet, we will reduce the amount of miles that I do because you don't want to put that much mileage on your legs to just let them rest and get ready for a big day. I plan on running for the University of Alabama. I just want to work up towards going to the Olympics in 2020. I think I'll be ready.
Not only does Bailey work hard on the track, but she puts just as much effort into her schoolwork.
Bailey is a great student. She is very hardworking, particular about making sure she gets her work and gets it done and does it to the best that she can every time. She's always looking to improve, always looking to make sure she does things right.
Because I used to play a lot of different sports, and then I just saw that running was my favorite. Whenever we had to get in trouble, you know, when you get in trouble, you have to run for different sports. Well, I always like to run, so I just said, hey, why not run?
Just because Bailey is a student athlete does not mean she gets special treatment. The bar is actually set higher.
There's no reason for them to need to set a lower standard for themselves.
In doing such rigorous training, Bailey does not push herself too hard before a meet.
I come to school and I do my work at school and then I go home. I train, I practice, I go to practice, and then after practice, I sit down, I do like 2 hours or an hour at least a night of studying and homework and stuff that needs to get done. And I try my best, like sometimes I'll go during lunch and go to the library and just get it done so that I won't have to do it that night.
If anything, I have higher expectations for my student athletes because I know that they're used to pushing themselves in competitions, so for them to push themselves in the classroom should be really a logical extension of their competitive athletic nature.
It feels great. I mean, especially by the school, everybody, I have a lot of fans, and my fans keep me going through it all, and so I really appreciate it. It's nice.
So how far does this star athlete plan to take her talents with running? Well, let's just say that we see a gold in her future.
All I can say is never give up. People say that it's hard, oh, I can't do it. They see how much you have to do, and then they just don't want to do it. All I can say is keep pushing yourself. Don't slack off. Don't say you can't, because anything is possible. I didn't get where I am today just by waking up one morning and being state champion. You got to work. If you work, you'll get there.
Bailey hopes to run for the University of Alabama in Tuscaloosa this fall.
Cross country isn't the only sport Cane Ridge students excel at. And while you may not be able to get a varsity letter for skateboarding, you can still set your sights high. Kareem Da Silva shows us how Julio Feliciano rose.
Cane Ridge High School contains a variety of unique students, one of which is Julio Feliciano. Julio is a gifted student with a fiery passion for skateboarding. Julio maintains his school life and skateboarding career in good balance.
I'd say I started skateboarding when I was like 10. And at first I wasn't as progressive as I am now, but as soon as I turned 12, I started to pick up. There's quite a few. I broke my arm and my collarbone and both my feet and my femur and my radius. And I did the other day dislocated my ring finger. It's all free will, really. So I guess like I get bored, really, and I need to learn something else so I don't get bored with my old tricks.
And what process do you do to learn new tricks?
I just do them over and over and over again. Practice makes perfect.
Skateboarding in Nashville can be very difficult.
I think there's one main thing. A lot of the times the spots here in Nashville are all spread apart. They're normally like a 10-minute ride on a car away from each other. So you can't really skate around and find new spots.
Have you ever been on tour?
I've been on 3 tours in my life. One was to Madrid, Spain with Adidas. The other one was, it was a Stoops tour 2008, and that was to in Europe. It was in England, and then I went to Finland, and then we went to Germany, and then we came back to France, and that's when we departed.
Before we go, Julio gives us 3 tips for rookies.
3 tips. Practice hard. Don't whine like a baby. Take the pain.
What type of board do you have?
I have a 825 reel with Thunder Trucks and Spitfire wheels with bone red bearings, and I'm riding a Black Magic grip tape.
We'll show you more talented students in a few minutes. But first, Cambridge students took some time recently to get an up-close look at professionals in Nashville's creative arts community. Here are some highlights from Artworks.
I think the Frist Center has made a big impact on the community just by making the visual arts available and accessible. We do believe in the power of art to change lives, and so the way to do that is to get as many people in as we can.
My name is Blair Bodine. I'm the Director of Education and Community Engagement for the Nashville Symphony. So many things about my job. I would say one of the perks to working in educational programming is how much you get to work with other students, how much you get to work with teachers and with schools. Probably my favorite part about my job is being able to interact with the people and with the participants in our programs. So our mission is not only a commitment to excellence with our artistic products, so our concerts and the symphony, but also a commitment to education and community engagement. So I'm lucky because my job title is literally in the mission. And I get to live out that mission every day.
My name is Kelly Hicks, and I'm the curator of moving images at the Country Music Hall of Fame and Museum. My job impacts the community oftentimes in hidden ways. A lot of how my work impacts the community is simply by being kind of invisible and making the magic happen. My work also impacts the community when I get a chance to go out to a film festival and introduce a screening, or go out into Nashville somewhere and show some footage that we preserve from the archive. Especially something unusual that people don't normally get to see.
Back to another talented Raven. Some people are born to be in the spotlight, while others prefer to be behind the scenes. Sandra Washington introduces you to a student who is a cut above the rest.
My favorite piece that I've done so far was when I made it look like a pencil was going through my wrist. That was a lot of fun.
Cane Ridge has the bloodiest ways to express talent. Out of 1,700 students, this one will make you want to take a second glance.
One day I was in lunch and I saw these kids have like blood and bruises on their hands out of nowhere, and I got a little bit freaked out and I was like, what's going on here? Like, everybody's bleeding. And then I go see that Amaris is on the lunch table doing stage makeup on some of the kids, and I was really fascinated by it.
Amaris Diaz, a junior at Cane Ridge High, has been creating fake cuts on people for the past 1 to 2 months. She learned how to create them on her own this past summer, finding the makeup online.
The whole Halloween time coming around really inspired me to start doing the makeup. It only takes like 5 or 10 minutes to do like a small cut. For something bigger or more intricate, it could take like 15, 20 minutes.
The cuts look so realistic that you'd think a professional made them, but Diaz's gift lets her create them and expand the unique talents found at Cane Ridge High School.
Well, after starting the year 0-4, it looked like the Ravens football team had no shot at the playoffs, but somehow they turned everything around and racked up a winning season. Marquise Hogue sits down with Coach Parks to look back at last season and look ahead to next year.
Hello, my name is Marquise Hogue, and I'm with Coach Jonathan Parks. Welcome to Coach's Corner. How you doing, Coach?
Doing great.
Great. So, how would you say this year's team differs from last year's team?
Last year's team was more about the hunger and the willingness to win. Mm-hmm. We brought in a brand new coaching staff, brought in a brand new offense, brought in a different defense from what we did the previous years, and there was a lot of excitement. And the hunger was there to learn and to get on a winning tradition and bring winning tradition to Cane Ridge, and to instill winning as being important, and the game of football being important in the school. This year's team was more about perfecting what we're trying to accomplish, carrying on a winning tradition, carrying on the new offense, the new defense, and putting players in the right position to make plays. And I think we were very successful both years in building the tradition of winning, building different school traditions, just like we run down the hill on Friday night. That was something we added last year and continue to do this year, and we'll continue to do that in years to come. And it just brings excitement to the game. When you have things like tradition that you always gonna do, when people come watch and young brothers and players from middle schools come to games and they see you do all these special things, it makes them want to come and be a part of that.
So I know you used to play at MT, and so what drove you from kind of like switching up from being play pro ball from being a head coach? Is that always what you wanted to do, be a head coach?
My senior year, in high school, there was a player spotlight, and I was picked on the player spotlight, and the news channel in Nashville came and interviewed me, and they asked, what are my future plans? And my future plans have always been to coach. I've always wanted to coach. I've always had that passion for learning the game and understanding the game and wanting to carry the tradition of the game on to guys like you and the rest of the football team. And I knew in my heart that I always wanted to do that. After I left Hunter's Lane and went to MTSU, I still felt that desire. I ended up changing my major one time, thought I wanted to be a police officer and get into criminal justice and stuff like that. And after one semester of that, I realized, nope, I want to go back to what I've always known because that's all I do know. You know, I'm used to getting up at 6:15, going to school. I'm used to going to football practice. I'm used to having a summer break, a Christmas break, a fall break. And, you know, I like routine. And routine's a big part of my life. Routine's a big part of my family's life. And when we get out of routine, which a lot of jobs cause you to not have a routine because they give you certain hours and then they'll change it and stuff like that, I knew I wanted to be in the school setting.
Okay, so let's talk about the season a little bit. So when you guys start off, when we start off 0-4, what did you say to your players to kind of like turn the season around? Because that had to be stressful on you a little bit.
Well, we started off the season with our rival down the road, Antioch, and we went into that game prepared, ready to win. We had some scrimmages that against schools that run the same scheme that our rival Antioch runs, and the hype itself in the game, I knew we were going to be prepared. Yeah. I don't have to get you guys motivated to play Antioch.
No.
They're our rival, and I think that's one of the things that we've instilled in this program is rivalry. You understand rivalry.
Yeah.
You understand the importance. And we had some plays not go our way against Antioch, and they ended up beating us. If we would have won that game, there's no telling what this season would have turned out to be. I mean, we could have ended up being 10-0 for all we know. Anytime you start a season off 0-4, your whole world turns upside down. In fact, there was just so much going on. Administration wondering what's going on. Coaches questioning what they're doing. Me question what am I doing wrong from this year that I did last year to cause us to play like we did. And the ball just didn't roll our way the first four games. It didn't.
One thing I want to ask you, I know you've been around Cane Ridge for a while now, a little bit, and you've seen like 1-9 teams and 0-10 teams, and then you come along and you bring them to the playoffs, I mean, 2 years in a row. That's great. I mean, it's really great. So how does that make you feel? I mean, to see like what we were, and then when you come along, you can turn that around.
Well,
I mean, it has to make you feel like, you know, you're doing something right, so.
My big thing is it's not anything that I necessarily did. It is more of what you guys bought in to what I was doing. I'm a big person on attention to detail. Attention to detail when it comes to practice and how we do things. You're not going to walk on that game field and see a crooked line. You're not going to walk on that game field and step off and the lines aren't exactly 5 yards apart. When we do our pregame warm-ups, you're not going to have guys running around not knowing where to go. There are certain things we do, and that's how we do it. And there are certain things that we wear, and we do it for a reason. You guys don't see a lot of times about why is he getting on me for wearing this jewelry? Why is he getting on to me for wearing a different sock? But it's those little things that carry you down the road when things get close. When there's a tight ball game, when adversity smacks you in the face, those are the things that carry you through the adversity and help you fight through it. And to be a part of teams that have done the 1-9s, the 0-10s, and been a part of that, and to see the heartbreak and the misery of coming to practice and the daily grind, not really being a grind, but yet a loafing session.
Yeah.
It wasn't fun for me either. But the passion, my passion for this game will always keep me around, whether we're 10-0 or 0-10. Yeah. And it ultimately comes to you guys. I want to give you guys the best football experience that you can ever have.
So when you first became head coach, you brought in a new coach staff. You know, you got Coach Arnold and Henderson and Smith, you know, all them. And when they first came in, how hectic was it? How has it changed now? So, because, I mean, last year it kind of had to be like we kind of had to get a feel for each other. So how is it different now?
Well, anytime you get a group of guys together, you got to get a group of guys that you trust.
Yeah.
And I brought in some guys that I trusted, and we have meetings, and I told them, this is what I expect. This is how we're going to do things. And when we first started last year, we were overcoaching everything.
Yeah.
But that's because we wanted to be good. We wanted to turn you guys into that dominant school in our region that nobody wants to play and everybody fears.
Yeah.
And we were overcoaching big time. I feel that bringing in this new staff caused us to have change. It caused us to have excitement. Defense wins championships.
Right.
Offenses fill the stands.
Yeah.
And I feel that we've done that. You go back and look at our last year's games, and you look on film, and there are people just lined up all the way around the fence. You look at the first game we had this year, there's people lined up all the way around the – it's huge. And that's what Friday Night Lights is all about,
right.
is big crowds, winning tradition, and playing for the people in your community and in your school. And I think we are building that winning tradition here at Cane Ridge, and I think it starts with me. I think it starts with the coaching staff and then trickles down to the players and then trickles down to their brothers that are coming and so on and so forth. And once you start that winning tradition, everybody wants to back you.
Well, thank you for being with us today, Coach Parks.
Thank you.
All right. And thank you for being at Coach's Corner.
Before we go, the world's most popular sport sometimes takes a backseat to other sports here in America. Here's a student who is making people stand up and take notice of the real football.
If you go to Cane Ridge High School and you like soccer, you know who Roberto Vicentino is. But while football players get most of the headlines and fame, some athletes in less popular sports aren't acknowledged as much.
Growing up was not as easy as most people live it. Being born in Mexico was hard to succeed, and even now, living in a country of opportunity.
Roberto says that at first, he had no interest in soccer until he noticed he was gifted.
It's not all about money, it's what you achieve on the pitch. No crowd, no coaches, no distractions. That's when champions are made. So my answer to all my problems is soccer.
That's all the time we have for right now.
Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time.
And good night.